Shannon, Leto, Maud, Harold's in the other room being punished. But Shannon, 30 seconds to Mars. How's it going? Glad to have you here today. I've been a Vader artist since 2010. I was with another company for years and years, and then I picked up a pair of Vader sticks and tried them out, and it was just an obvious switch for me. And I wanted a new perspective in my playing, and I wanted to, I'm always trying to challenge myself and take risk, and it was just a perfect match for me. And, you know, they hold up to my playing, and Maud likes them, so it's really all that matters. I guess I started playing, instruments were around my household growing up. They were kind of my toys. We were really, really poor, and we were living on communes growing up, so I didn't have TV or G.I. Joes or anything like that. So I had all these, these bongos that were around, people were playing, and these drum circles and guitars and makeshift instruments and percussion. And they really were my toys. And that's when, that's when I was introduced to instruments. And I remember also I would be at my grandparents' house just making these drums out of like pots and pans and very early age, and I think that's when I discovered that I like to play drums, like the beat on it. I love playing guitar, I love playing piano, I love music. I love music, it makes sense, for me. And it just completes me, man. I wasn't really the traditional kind of drummer. I never took lessons. I didn't have the patience, really. I hated school, so I was kind of that guy and that kid. So my brain really works fast and worked fast. So I was always reading faster than everybody, and I was just bored in class. And so I would just, with that being said, I just couldn't see myself sitting and being instructed to play. So I kind of just did what I wanted to. I would listen to all sorts of different types of music. Anywhere from Joni Mitchell, my mom would listen to Joni Mitchell, Fleetwood Mac, to Boz Scaggs, to Steely Dan, to Led Zeppelin, to Kiss. I loved Kiss. First grade, that's a funny story. First grade, I was a thief too. So first grade, I stole Kiss Destroyer album, and I was like, I don't know, five or something, or whatever you are, or however old you are when you're in first grade. I remember they had show and tell class. I remember bringing the album to class. I loved the album. I would stare at the album, the burning city in the back, and those guys up there on the mountain. And anyways, I brought it into show and tell, and everybody was bringing their dolls or bringing their like toy houses. And I remember like taking the album out, and that's right, an album. I'm old, an album, and showing it to the class, and I'd be explaining like, yeah. And I had such a crazy imagination, no toys or TV, so I was left really alone with this. And anyways, I'd be like, yeah, there's the burning city, and that's where I would live, and I'd be running away from people that were chasing, like it was, and the class was silent. It was like a movie, like everybody was silent, and you could hear a pin drop. And the teacher was just like, when I was finished, she was like, okay, Shannon, you can go sit down now, okay. And I felt a weird energy, and that was me as a kid, the weird abstract boy. But I did join a jazz workshop when I was 12 or 13, and that's when I was introduced to playing in a structured way. And there was no music. I didn't have to read music or anything like that. It's just based on, the conductor kind of telling us what to play. And so I did that, and we traveled. Like, I was living in, like, I think, New York at the time, the city, and we traveled to, like, Philly and stuff like that. We traveled around. It's a bunch of kids at a community center, Jazz Workshop Community Center. And we traveled around, and it was fun. It was great. I loved that feeling of performing in front of people. And everybody was great. So the second time, I wanted to do it again. So second season came up, and I didn't know how to read music. Okay, so he threw this on me. Okay, I took the whole thing personal. He threw this on me. He's like, "All right, we're gonna hear some music, and I mean, you're gonna be tested, you know, and we're gonna have music that you have to read, and it's gonna be Owner of a Lonely Heart by Yes." And I remember thinking, like, oh, I know the song. You know, I could hear a song and I could be, oh, I know that song, no problem. So I went in and he put the music up, and I was just, I mean, I didn't know how to transcribe. I didn't know anything about, you know, sheets of music. So I totally f***ed up. I didn't play it right, you know, and didn't get called back, took it totally personally. So that just, you know, reinforced my whole, you know, f*** you to everything. And so I just continued playing drums on my own, and I played all different styles, you know. There's not one drummer I can really that stands out that got me really. It basically, I just listened to everything, and I think how I practiced was I would listen to a song and. I mean, not, I think, I know, I would listen to a song and I would always listen to the melody and the vocal of the song. And I would play a simple beat, and then I would follow with my left hand, like, the vocal, you know, and then that developed my kind of, like, polyrhythmic type of thing that I do. And it was like this, it was like a hobby. I'd be sitting in a car even, I'd just be doing this, and then I'd be doing, like, you know, I'd be tapping my finger with the vocal and that built up, that type of playing, mentally and physically. So later on, I stepped away from playing drums and just kind of, you know, dropped out of school and did a whole, you know, for years, like this whole, you know, so kind of lifestyle. And then I picked it back up. When I was like 23, 24, and it was my brother and I, Jared, we just started playing because we grew up with, it was just, oh, let's just, you know, I'll get some drums and the other guitar, and, you know, we'll just play just to play as like a hobby type thing. And I think that's when I knew in my life, like, oh, this makes sense. This is kind of making sense. This feels right. Because I didn't know what I was gonna do, so I was like, I was like, oh, I was playing, and it was just making sense. I was playing guitar, coming up with songs, and we were like, yeah, there's something going on here. So we basically just played in our bedrooms, and rented spaces when we could, and just played. And it was kind of like this like compulsive thing and obsessive thing. We just played. And then later on, we wanted to, like 97 or something, we wanted to make a CD, so we set out to do that, and we made our first CD, we recorded it, we were like, oh, that's us, man, that's us, you know, and this recording, and then we decided to play out, you know, like, hey, why don't we just go play out, what a concept, playing out, so we played out, and that was it. That was that was kind of like, okay, this is what we're definitely gonna do and pursue. So we played out, and then we set out to get a record deal, and that was in 98, and it took a long time. You know, my brother being my brother and an actor and all that, people were a little trepidatious and developing a relationship with us and that, you know, and you know, and signing deals and stuff like that. So that took a minute. And then we finally signed in 98, end of 98, and with Immortal Records. And then Immortal Records, we signed with Virgin Records at the time. And then what we really did was we basically just, we still do today, we tour. You know, we knew that we had to tour. We wanted to build our family, our fan base. We just wanted to tour. And we did that. Our first record, self-titled first record, is basically everything that I've, you know, everything that led up to that point, I put into that album. You know, there's a lot going on. There's a lot of electronics, a lot of layers, a lot of tracks. And that was that. We had Bob Ezrin, which is funny because Bob Ezrin produced the Kiss record, Destroyer, and I thought that was pretty fucking cool, the circle, you know? And so we had him produce, and we did it, you know? And the rest is kind of, as I say, history. And we toured. We toured, you know, we were touring whenever, however, you know, we started touring in our cars. We had SUVs, my brother and I, these old SUVs, and with trailers on them, we toured with those, and then we moved up to a van, then we moved up to the RV, and then the bus. And our second record, A Beautiful Lie, I told myself that I would just throw away any old idea that I had of recording and just start new. And that's kind of like my thing. That's kind of like what I do, is just throw out. I'm interested in changing and growing, evolving. So I kind of just like throw out old ideas and just start new, you know? And so for A Beautiful Lie, you know, I did that, and we narrowed the songs down a little bit more, just being a little bit more concentrated on the songs and keep things a little more simple and more exact. So A Beautiful Lie, you know, that was going, you know, we were touring, getting better tours and all that. But still kind of, you know, we wanted, something needed to happen, you know. And then our single, The Kill, was doing okay. And so then, you know, we decided to show ourselves, because we weren't really showing ourselves in videos and stuff like that. So my brother decided to direct this video and show ourselves, and after that video, it just, the Kill just blew up, and that's when, you know, everything started, you know, changing a little bit. So the next album, This Is War, was and is something completely different from all the other albums. We had Flood work on it with us. As you know, he's done U2, he's done Depeche Mode, amazing producer. And we also had Steve Lillywhite, who's also done U2 albums and collaborated with Flood, so it was a perfect match. And what I wanted to get out of that album was I wanted to get the truest sound that came from the drum as possible. So what helped with that is recording at me and my brother's house. And so all the live drums were recorded at the house, and all the samples that were used were created at the house, and everything was at the house, you know, different parts of the house. And that contributed to the unique sound that we have on the album. You know, there's a lot going on during that making of the record. We were being sued for $30 million from our record company. A new president was being elected. The world was melting financially. So all these things were happening. And I think if we weren't going through those situations, those challenges, we wouldn't have the sound of This Is War that we have today. So I think it was kind of just, you know, it was meant to be. And really, we've just been we've been touring for about a year and a half straight. And we're probably gonna end up touring a little over 2 years. And it's the greatest thing, the greatest thing. And these Vader sticks are really fucking great. I love how there's no lacquer. I like how it's just raw, you know? These are the nude, 5A nude. And they just work. They don't slip out of my hand. They're solid. I hardly break them. And the people that work there are really, really cool. The customer care, I mean, and that's really important for me, to have a relationship with the people that I'm working with. The open communication, open door policy is really, because I mean, we're all in it together. That's kind of how I run my world. We're all trying to win, right? We're all trying to do the best job we can. So, you know, those guys are great. These sticks are great. Maud loves them. She fiddles around. She wants to be a drummer, but, you know, she doesn't really practice, so she's never really gonna do anything. She's so funny, isn't she? Attitude, looking away, like, what? Anyways. Vader sticks, yeah, they're just, they're great, they're great, they're great. They hold up to my playing, they hardly break. And I like how I like the weight of the 5A. I like the length of the 5A. I like the balance of the 5A. You know, I like how these are there's no lacquer, it's just nude. The grip is just perfect. And I like to play with the nylon tip because I like the sound that it produces with my the Remo drum heads that I use. And I like the sound that it produces when I hit the ride. It just adds that extra top end that I like. You know, touring, we've fortunately been able to tour around the world literally a few times, and we've played, I think, everywhere except for Antarctica or something. I mean, we even shot a video 200 miles in the Arctic Circle, so we were there too. But so that being said, you get to see a lot of interesting, crazy things out there, and really things that you're just like, that are just mind blowing. That, you know, like when we played, like the beginning of our of this album cycle, we got to play Rock'em Ring and Germany, and we played Rock'em Ring earlier on our last, during our last album, and we were playing like the first band or something. So there were just a few people, a lot of people, but there were a few people there. So we went back with this album and we played it, and it was just like, there was a moment. And I don't get these moments because I'm so involved in what I'm doing and I get lost in the song. But there's this moment where I was looking out and, you know, I couldn't even see the end of, I mean, the crowd was so massive and so just awesome that when I was looking out, I was trying to like, I was playing. So then I got wrapped up in looking at the people and I was playing and I was trying to see where it ended. And I was like, where's the end? And my brother was doing this thing with his hands and people were, you know, just going back and forth and back and forth. And I was just getting so caught up that I forgot where I was playing for a second and had to like snap out of it. And Tomo, the guitar, he was looking at me, he was like, uh-uh. And so I got back. I was like, two measures or something. And that was pretty awesome. That was pretty cool to just see and feel those people and that communication and that exchange happening. I am involved with this project I've been working on. They're called CB7. So I've been like producing and managing them. They're a brand new band and they're on tour with us now. And I started working with them a couple years ago. And that, when I started doing that, I was like, oh, I can also do this. So that's something that I found that I'm interested in as well, developing bands, I guess. I guess that's what that is, right? And it's exciting, you know, taking something and someone has this idea and taking it and then helping them formulate it and make it a reality. And I mean, music's trippy because it's like something that comes from in here, right? You know, not really here. So it's here or wherever the fuck it comes from. And then you put it into an instrument, you know, or, you know, and then you record it and, you know, and then you have it. It's fucking magical. There's nothing like it, you know, there's really nothing like it. And I think it's important, I think I strayed away from this, but for kids to have music in school, personally, I think it you know, allows them to explore a part of themselves that helps open their mind up, helps them to see things a little differently than just the you know, the norm. Like just to go into your math class, go into your biology class, just going to these classes and just reading, studying, remembering. I think it helps exercise the brain in a really positive way. I wish there were more music, you know, classes in schools, but and I think there are more and more. They're coming up more and more now. All right, so I guess Maude's hungry. I guess she is. I mean, she hasn't really eaten, have you? You skinny beanpole. Look at her. Anorexic. Models. She's like a poster child for like the model diet. Aren't you, Maude? So that's it. Nice talking to you. Very cool. Going through memory lane with you. I want to thank Vader Styx for helping me play my best. You know, if you want to follow me on Twitter, it's @ShannonLeto, and you know, I put a lot of anyways, check it out. It's funny. I talk about like, you know, ridiculous things and about behind the scenes type activities that go on, and what cities we're going to be in and all that. And you can follow Vader as well. But anyways, thank you very much. Great talking to you. Shannon Leto, Maude, 30 Seconds to Mars. Ciao. We went to